warmer world a better world? I mean, who minds a little warmer weather, right? I'm from Toronto, where our winters are cold and our summers are short. One of my favorite pictures of Toronto shows a tropical beach photoshopped over the shoreline with a label that says, Canadians for Global Warming. On a chilly day, when we hear about how the planet is warming, you can understand how someone might think, well, what's so bad about that? I'd like a little global warming, please. Others might say, humans are so resilient. Clearly we can adapt. In fact, who knows, a warmer Earth might even be better for us. Less ice and snow to scrape off the car and a longer growing season, right? It's true that we humans are remarkably resilient. But it wasn't till the last few thousand years that our civilization really took off. Why? One of the biggest reasons is because we had the perfect climatic conditions, not just to hunt and gather, but to build and grow. So why does the warming we've experienced so far, 1 degree Celsius or nearly 2 degrees Fahrenheit, matter? And what is the perfect temperature for our planet anyways? There's no perfect temperature for the planet itself, but there is a perfect temperature for us. Not too hot and not too cold. In fact, the best conditions for us are the exact conditions that we've already had over the last few thousand years. So why are warmer temperatures a bad thing? Because they're not what we're used to. Sure, a degree or four might not sound like that much, but over the course of human civilization, our planet's temperature has been as stable as that of a human body. And we all know that even if our temperature is already a warm 98 degrees, if it shoots up a few degrees, we have a serious problem. I've talked before in this series about how climate, temperature, rainfall, weather patterns, and more, critically affects the resources we depend on, and even the land that our homes and cities are built on. We can't just pick up Miami or Vancouver or Shanghai and move them inland as the oceans rise. If our water resources run out, we can't just tap into someone else's. If our crops fail, they can't say, oh well, let's just move the farm somewhere else. Most available land has already been parceled out, as have most of our water resources. We've built our civilization on the assumption that climate is stable. The rapid change we're experiencing today, faster than anything humans have ever witnessed before, including the warming after the last ice age, upends that assumption of stationarity. These rapid changes have the potential to devastate our resources, our economy, and more. But what you might not realize is that warmer temperatures actually affect our bodies directly as well. As the planet warms, extreme heat and heat waves are getting more intense and more frequent. And in addition to the toll this takes on our health, higher temperatures also make us mad. Yeah, you heard that right. As temperatures rise, people's tempers flare too. To investigate this on a small scale, scientists have put people in rooms with different temperatures, from cooler to hotter, and then given them a time-sensitive task to do. They found that anger and irritability increased as the temperature in the room went up. The real world bears this out. Combing through data on heat and violence, scientists have found that warmer cities see more violent crime than similar cities in cooler regions. Crime rates are already higher in the summer, so as summers get longer and hotter, it's likely that crime will also increase. Another study in Mexico found links between higher than normal temperatures and more frequent murders, drug cartel-related deaths, and even suicide rates. That's not all. Higher temperatures also make it harder for us to sleep. New research has linked heat waves with self-reported complaints about difficulty sleeping. And people who are poor and the elderly, those least likely to be able to afford air conditioning, reported having the most trouble. It's not only about temperature. Climate change affects rainfall patterns, bringing more frequent heavy downpours in some areas and stronger droughts in others. In countries that may be already teetering on the brink of disaster due to social, political, economic, or cultural stresses, climate change can be the final straw that breaks the camel's back. We've already seen this happen in Syria, a country that faced a terrible drought from 2006 to 2011, a drought that was 2 to 3 times more likely as a result of human-induced climate change. Experts believe it was one of multiple contributing factors that led to the Syrian civil war and the refugee crisis, which is still raging today, with nearly 5 million people displaced outside their country. But over this coming century, it's estimated that sea level rise alone could displace as many as 2 billion people living in coastal zones, 13 million of those in the United States, if they don't or can't adapt. Why do we care about all of this? Because no matter who we are or where we live, we all want a safe world for ourselves, our families, and others too. We know what the perfect temperature of this planet is for us. It's what we've had all along. That's why we need to act now while we still can, because the faster we cut our carbon emissions, the better off we'll all be. Thank you for watching Global Weirding. Be sure to check out globalweirdingseries.com every other Wednesday for a new episode. Don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube page, like us on Facebook, and follow me on Twitter. Have a question about climate change? We want to hear it. We'll have a live Q&A on our Facebook page every other Thursday at 7 p.m. Central. See you next time.